I want to analyze Gene Kim's take on pre or post trib in 2 Thessalonians 2. And this is his Bible channel here, and you can see he's very, very popular.
People use 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3 through 4 to prove that the day of Christ, which is the rapture, cannot happen until after the Antichrist is revealed. However,
now, are you catching that?
Which is the rapture cannot happen until after the Antichrist is revealed.
That's right. The rapture happens after the Antichrist is revealed. All right, so we can take comfort knowing, hey, we know who the Antichrist is, and we know that the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ is coming soon, right?
However, they fail to read the context. Verse 1 shows that the day of Christ is not just the rapture, it includes the second coming of Jesus Christ.
That's right. So the day of Christ, the day of the Lord, the great day of the Lord, the coming of, you know, the coming Christ, the gathering together, the rapture, there are different names given to it, but it's all the same day. Judgment day, same day. It's all the same day. It's all what is to be expected. All right, this great separation of good and evil, the great day of the Lord. This is all what, it's everything that we expect, that we hope for, where the wicked is done away with forever and we are transformed into our everlasting bodies, where we go from corruptible to incorruptible forever, where there's no more pain, no more sorrow, and no more death. All right, for these things, they'll be things of the past, and there's a new heaven and a new earth. So this is all, the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ is the rapture, it's judgment day, it's all that, it's all coming.
His advent, when he conquers the Antichrist, it shows the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, second advent, and our gathering together, the rapture.
Wait, what did he say? Second advent? So, did he say second advent? Advent, right there. Christ has ad. Wait, hold on a second. I'm not sure what he's saying.
Christ, his advent, when he conquers the Antichrist, it shows the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
All right, so I'm dumb. I don't know squat. What? Oh my goodness. Can we just give me a definition of what is advent? I don't know. Arrival of a notable person. Alright, so what's wrong with saying the coming of our Lord? I don't know why people gotta use fancy words all the time. Let me see. Oh, let's see, I can't even spell. That's the other problem that I have. I can't spell and I don't know words. So, looks like I'm wrong. This word is, oh no, adventure. No. There is no advent.
Christ, second advent, and our gathering together, the rapture. In verse 8, it shows that his coming is truly the second advent when he conquers the Antichrist. We, on the other hand, the rapture, it is not in the tribulation.
So now he says second advent. Is this, Jesus is going to come? And then he's going to be here, and then he's going to come again? Does that make any sense to you?
8, it shows that his coming is truly the second advent when he conquers the Antichrist. We, on the other hand, the rapture, it is not in the tribulation with the Antichrist. The context of verse 8 through 12 shows that it's not we Christians, but they, the lost world.
Is any of this making any sense to you?
is truly the second advent when he conquers the Antichrist.
See, that second advent, what's he talking about? He sneaks that in there.
Conquers the Antichrist. It shows the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Alright, so, I'm not sure that I understand what he's saying. He's mixing words, talking fast, and then concludes that there's two comings, I don't know what he's saying. Let's just real quickly. This takes less than, maybe 3 minutes to read this? Now we besiege you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled, neither by spirit nor by word nor by letter as of from us, that the day of Christ is at hand. Now pay attention here. Let no man deceive you by any means. By any means, let no man deceive you. For that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. This day is already upon us, man. When this was written, it was not upon them, but it's upon us now. There's no way around it. Absolutely no way around it. You cannot say this is going to... I mean, the futurists say it, but you cannot honestly say this is going to be something that happens in the future. Because, for one thing, it's never going to happen. And then for another thing, if Jesus comes today, you're going to tell him, oh, you can't come yet. Lord, Lord, you can't come yet. The Antichrist hasn't come yet. Well, he's going to tell you, hey, buddy, he's been here the whole time. You missed it. You failed to put your faith in the Word of God, and you trusted men rather than God. And that's why you're blinded. Read this. Who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God, as the Holy Father, as the Pope in Rome, sitteth in the temple of God in the Roman Catholic Cathedral, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? And now ye know that what withholdeth that he might be revealed in his time? Yeah, he's been revealed. We can see him today, clear as day. Of course, you have to believe in the scripture. You have to believe in Jesus Christ. I mean, come on, man. For the mystery of iniquity does already work. So that spirit, the iniquity was already there in play. And it's been in play, you know, since really the garden, since the serpent beguiled Eve. And then we see the spiritual line of wickedness, of iniquity, all the way to the end until Jesus stomps it out for good. Okay. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. So this is, I guess, the advent. I'm still not even sure what that word means. Arrival. Okay. I hate that word. I don't like it. It's not wrong. It's just confuses. Why not just say this coming? The coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. What's wrong with that? Why do we got to change words and make this more confusing? Anyways, when Jesus comes, he's going to destroy all wickedness, including the son of perdition, the Antichrist. Okay, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. But we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God has from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth, whereunto he called you by our gospel to the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. All right, so once saved, always saved is the gospel. If you believe in Jesus Christ and you are born of the Spirit of God, you shall never die. Once saved, always saved. Okay. Saved, secure, sealed, sanctified forever. Now, all this is going to happen at the return, or the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, or the Advent, whatever the hell the Advent means. All right, so now that we understand, very easily, very simple, it's not rocket science, man. It's very clear.
It's the Antichrist. It shows the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, second Advent, and our gathering together, the rapture. In verse 8, it shows that his coming is truly the second Advent when he conquers the Antichrist. We, on the other hand, the rapture, it is not in the tribulation with the Antichrist.
Are you catching that? He is just skipping over. He's using the word Advent, which was really, really confusing. What he's saying is, Jesus Christ comes, we're raptured, and then the Antichrist comes, and then Jesus Christ comes again. It makes no sense at all. It's not supported by this chapter, 2 Thessalonians 2. It's not supported by any chapter, any verse, anywhere in the Bible at all. What he's presenting here is comic book stuff. It's Hollywood movie stuff. It's very popular, no doubt about it. And he's got the majority on his side that agree. The problem is, it's wrong. There is no second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ in the air. When he comes in the air, that's it. It's the end of the world.
Context of verse 8 through 12 shows that it's not we Christians, but they, the lost world. Verse 13 and 14 shows we Christians are called to glory. In Colossians chapter 3 and verse 4, it shows that we are raptured in heaven with Jesus Christ when we're called to glory. Verse
4. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him.
Or it shows that we
glory. Alright, so we go here, let's do it this way so I can find it real quick. Wherefore he called you by our gospel to the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So Gene Kim wants to say this happens, and then what happened? And then this happened. And so he's just going whatever order he wants to go in. Right? It doesn't matter what the Bible says. It's just, we got to fit this in a way that fits, you know, the Hollywood narrative. Right? That we're going to have, Jesus is going to come and rapture us away. And then there's going to be this period of time on earth when there's no saved people. And this will be like a last chance for the unsaved people. And there's going to be zombies. And there's going to be, you know, zombie hunts. And there's going to be, you know, last man standing sort of Hollywood movie sort of Eli stuff or whatever, you know. It's going to be crazy, you know. And then, I mean, what are we going to be doing up? And we're going to be up in the sky eating popcorn, looking down, watching zombies, you know. Hey, that's fantastic, man. That's great. That's terrific. But it's not true. All right, it's ridiculous. It's Hollywood movie stuff. It's fantasy world stuff. It's sci-fi. It's popular, but it's not true. It's ridiculous. These guys are selling a ridiculous doctrine, a ridiculous idea of the end time, when the end time is so much better, or so much easier and simpler to understand and better. When you realize when Jesus comes in the clouds of heaven, it is the end of the world. Just like what we read in Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21, and all through Revelation, all through the whole entire Bible, when the Lord Jesus Christ comes in this air, in the heavens, that's the end of the world. You can't get around it, man. You're selling sci-fi fantasy world stuff. Come on, man. All right, so if you can make sense out of this video, good for you, man. Good for you. I can't make any sense. He's trying to say that we're going to be taken up in the sky and there's going to be zombies, zombie wars. Da 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 da. And then, you know, what about the superheroes, man? Aren't you going to promote the superhero stuff? You know, the fallen angels or the, you know, the... Oh, I'm going to get into that. I'm going to do another video. I'm going to get into that. Hold on a second. Anybody here with eyes? How can Christians claim that it is Satan's wrath when Jesus himself opens the seven seals and his angels blow the trumpet? Okay. Pre-tribulation. All right, there. Yep. Whatever you say, Dr. Gene Kim. I won't read the Bible. I just take whatever you say, that's what I believe. Yeah. Let's not read the Bible. Let's just listen to men. The rapture of the church and the second coming of Christ are two entirely different events. There's somebody that is just... There we go. God's beautiful flat earth. And this is another thing. You claim to put the truth above everything. You claim to put the truth above all else. And then you're going to claim that the rapture and the second coming are two different events. I don't think you care about the truth at all. Let's just read what he says, and then I'll close it out. Jesus. Okay. The rapture is when the Lord meets us in the air to take us to heaven for the 7-year marriage. So that's brilliant. Let's just add something in there that's not in the Bible at all. 7-year marriage supper with the Lamb. That's not in the Bible, but, you know, somebody teaches it, so. While concurrently the son of perdition is revealed on the flat earth. Okay. Let's see, that's fantastic, man. You write a book on that, huh? They're making the start of the 7-year tribulation. And that's not in the Bible either. Alright, so you got two things in the Bible. Two things that are not in the Bible. Excuse me, the second advent, whatever the hell that means, is after the 7 years. I mean, look, you said the second coming right here. Why do you throw in second advent? What is the second advent? The third coming? Does that make any sense to anybody? It's like, you know, you go through school. If you ever went to the public school system, they teach you not to think. They teach you to repeat. All right, so the teacher will stand up there and she'll read, well, you know, 1492, whoever, you know, floated the ocean blue or whatever, you know, whatever they say, I don't remember. Like, I was bad in school, so I don't remember squat. You know how but that's how they do it. They don't want you to think. They want you to recite. Okay, and so that's what we have in the world today. A bunch of people who are not thinking, they are reciting or repeating what they've heard, their parents. So they've heard this, And they think they're smart because they can repeat what they heard. They do. It's true. So they repeat what they heard, but they don't put any thought into what they're saying or what they're repeating. They just repeat like a parrot, not putting any thought at all into what they're saying. This sounds great with Second Coming and then the Second Advent. And then in my head, of course, I'm thinking, what the hell is he talking about? Is that the Second Advent? Is that the Third Coming? What about the Fourth Coming? Teach me more about the Fourth Coming. I want to learn about this stuff. I really do want to know the truth. I don't care for this fantasy world crap here that's not supported. Hold on a minute. The Second Advent is after the 7 years. When the Lord comes to establish his 1,000-year reign. That's the three things right there in Jerusalem. There's three things right there that's not supported by the Bible at all. And that is the 7-year marriage supper with the Lamb. We're all going to sit around the table and eat for 7 years and drink a bunch of booze and just get stupid drunk. Meanwhile, there's a 7-year zombie period on Earth when zombies are running around blowing each other's heads off. All right. And so, it's just going to be one great big party, no matter how you look at it. And then the third coming of Jesus, which is the Second Advent, and which happens right before the fourth coming of Jesus, is when the Lord comes and he establishes 1,000-year reign. Jesus reigns for 1,000 years, you know, according to the experts. So Jesus comes and he reigns for 1,000 years. Now this is after the Second Advent, which is the third coming. So at the end, when Jesus is done reigning, when he's had enough of reigning, he's not going to reign no more at the end of the 1,000 years, when his reign is finished, and then you take over, or whoever, whether you or Gene Kim or whoever takes over after Jesus is done reigning. When that 1,000 years is over, then that's the fourth coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, right? The fourth coming or the third advent. So now we've established four times that Jesus is going to return. And that's just brilliant, isn't it? Because this here, right there, you can't get around that. That's the return of Jesus. And you want to say that's his fourth return or his fourth coming? Or, you know, maybe we're missing something here. Maybe this is the fifth return of Jesus. Huh? This is after the 1,000 years. And which, by the way, it doesn't say Jesus Christ reigns 1,000 years. I'm not sure if you've ever read Revelation 20. There's no mention of Jesus reigning 1,000 years. It's not there. It's not found anywhere in the Bible. But when you're a good student, you don't use your brain. You just repeat what you hear. It's like a parrot. You don't think about what you're hearing. You just repeat it, and then you pretend to be smart. And that's just brilliant, all right? So he says, when the Lord comes to establish his 1,000-year reign, even though it's not in the Bible, on this beautiful flat earth with us, and then the battle of Armageddon, get in at the end. And then the battle of Armageddon at the end again. And then the battle of Armageddon at the end. So, maybe this guy does have five comings or returns of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we got a second coming, and then a second advent is the third coming. And then we've got the fourth coming, which is at the end of the 1,000 years. And then there's the battle of Armageddon. Well, then he has to come again, doesn't he, after that? So that's five returns of the Lord Jesus Christ. What was we reading here? And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie. See? Oh, my goodness. I'd like to get into this and I'd like to get into that, but I'm just going to leave it right there. Is there hope for the world after the rapture? Jeez. Oh, I'm afraid to even answer that. There is no hope for the world after the rapture. The rapture is the end of the world. Have you not read Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21? I mean, let's read what he says. They have to have faith. So, there it is. Just wait until Jesus comes, and then you can believe. All right, you're going to see him coming in the sky, and wait till that happens, and then start to believe, right? Problem is, if you wait that long, it's too late. You've heard that song before, haven't you? Too late, right? It's too late. Too late. After Jesus comes, it is too late. I've never heard of this guy here. Never heard of that guy here. I haven't heard this song since I was a little boy. I'll play 2 seconds and then I'll close it out.
Too late.